Good morning. Thank you very much for the invitation to Lisbon, and thank you very much also for this very detailed description about my profile. This is my third time in Lisbon and fourth time in Portugal, and I started to feel a bit Portuguese. I'm very happy to be back here again. Today's speech is about food use for social innovation, optimizing food waste recovery strategies. And I will start with a question: what are the current challenges in the agro industry today? If we can describe it with one word, is sustainability. With the definition is of sustainability is the development that meet the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. The key concept of sustainability, in spite of, is a form of economic development to preserve the quality and kind of natural heritage under a regime social equity and environmental balance. And the needs, of course, priority should be given the essential needs of the world's poor. There are also limitations imposed by the state of the technology and social organization on the environment's stability to meet present and future needs. So why do we need sustainability is the next question. There is one reason. The reason is that we run out of sources, and we run out of sources now. So over the coming decades, the world will witness increased competition for limited and finite natural resources. World population will grow up to 8 billion in 7 years from now. So it's rather clear that we're going to have a lot of competition for all the kind of sources, food, water, and we have to work now from this point to see how we can manage in the future. The second reason is the food waste. One third of food produced for human consumption in the world is lost or wasted. The total wastage for the edible part of food accounts 1.3 gigatons of agricultural production. They say that if food waste was a country, it could be as big as Brazil or China, something like this. It's a really big problem. So food waste and byproducts defined in most European legislations due to the fact that they are defined as waste due to the fact that they are removed from the production line as undesirable materials. So this is why food waste has been considered as a matter of treatment, minimization, and prevention for more than 40 years. However, the current challenge demands their valorization as a source of high value components. Why? Because enormous amounts of food waste are discussed worldwide, but the technology nowadays promise the recovery and sustainability of high value ingredients inside food chain. So there are a lot of prospects in the field, but up to now, despite the many studies and the budget methodologies, the products, the marketed products are still rather limited. So this is what we're gonna discuss today about some innovation barriers. So industrialization of such processes includes different issues. First of all, laboratory research, transfer from pilot plant to full-scale production, and in some cases, protection of intellectual properties, with the development of applications, commercialization problems, or in case of some products, health claims, the approval. So all these are necessary issues to ensure sustainability and economic benefit for the involved in food industry. Other innovation barriers are more complicated things with regard to the material. For example, the waste collection in the source, it's very critical because waste and byproducts are already processed materials. This means that enzymatic and microbial reactions have already been accelerated during the production of foods. So thereby they deteriorate very fast. So this requires immediate transportation directly or control of microbial growth prior treating the materials to recover compounds. This can be solved with a proper management of collection processes and also some preservatives at the beginning of the process. Another big problem in the field is the broad content variation of bioresources. So you can get food waste, for example, olive meal waste. Typically, we talk about olive meal waste, which was my topic of my PhD. For example, you can get olive meal waste with 1,000 milligrams per liter polyphenols, but you can get another source for with 4,000 milligrams per liter. So if you want to extract compounds, you should consider this variation of the source, because then also maybe your final product will vary, the content of the final product will vary. This creates several problems. For example, the functionality of the products may be altered, and there are also mass and energy balance restrictions. There are some solutions, for example, to add a pretreatment step, and especially in wastewater, you can use a pretreatment step and concentrate the material as much as you want. Other problems are have to do with scale-up, which is typically occupied with rapid development of complex interactions like all the other food processes. There is extensive handling and increased air incorporation. So this is a drawback, because the recovered compounds are used in the recovered compounds may be screened and they lose part of their functionality. So this means that maybe you measure something in the lab, and then you, when you try to scale up the process, you lose some functionality. The final product is not so active, so you have to add higher concentration of the final compounds in the product. So this affects the organoleptic character of the final product, and of course, process cost is increased. So with regard to the commercial implementation, as you can see from these examples, that this can happen only if we have a certain degree of flexibility and alternative choices that can be adapted in the development methodologies. Simplified process with fewer steps tend to scale up easier and possess a cheaper production. As a very good rule is first think byproducts just to transform and use them directly in products before trying to recover compounds, if you can manage to do this. And what is very important, you have to remember that a project that focuses on the recovery technologies without establishing applications is doomed to fail. So it's very important to develop specific applications because, as I said, the final product might not be as beneficial as has been proposed. And it's difficult to survive competition as a non-specific functional ingredient. With regard to market release permission, if you clarify a lot of the material, safety of active compounds that are recovered in very poor form, they have to check similarly to synthetic compounds, synthetic antioxidants, for example. So this requires a long and sophisticated assays on different laboratory animals. On the other hand, if you have a natural extract, the criteria are not so strict. You can use it directly in food because they are considered as inherent food components, especially if you have used green solvents during the extraction. So concentration of compounds in crude extracts are a bit lower. So, and also they are co-extracted ingredients that affect negatively the taste. So all these are factors that should be taken into account. Now, with regard to the market needs for KFA products, generally consumers increasingly display preference for natural entities. This means that they have been generated without human intervention. So the consumers require also environmentally friendly food products. There is a lot of promotion of the green marketing today, organic and protected designate of origin. All these things create a challenging environment for food innovators. And these things have to take into account. Now, a big problem in the field of food waste recovery is the fact about the health claims. Authorities around the world, especially in Europe with EFSA, have tightened up the way in which companies can advertise health effects. So this policy is driven by the need of protecting consumers for dubious claims. So health claims have only been approved for a few compounds, only, for example, for hydroxytyrosol, which is a polyphenol in olive oil. So this is very complicated. If you recover hydroxytyrosol from olive meal waste and you put it in a bakery product, for example, you cannot have a health claim. If you recover hydroxytyrosol from olive meal waste water and you add the olive oil, again, you cannot have the health claim in the label. So this health claim is only for hydroxytyrosol with olive oils with high concentration of hydroxytyrosol and polyphenols. This strict environment for the companies that they have to prove the health claims, demonstration of the health claims is very costly, especially for some small companies that are activated in the field. It creates a stifling environment for innovations, since the risk of claims rejection is very high. The situation in US is a bit better, with FDA has already approved some more extracts with health claims for extracts from byproducts. And in Asia, the market's much more free. But our proposition of food waste recovery goals was to establish a new label for this kind of product, similar to organic foods or ecological footprint labels, for example, in order to allow this kind of companies to compete in the market. Other recommendations include the implementation of non-thermal technologies, addition of green solvents, for example, and safer materials. As I said, development of tailor-made applications is very important to include both recovery protocols and preservation assays. And also clear labels of the products containing recovered compounds would enable scientists in the field to recommend this kind of products. A clean label of the product, what is there, how did you extract it, if this is a green technology, all these are important. Now about some commercialized applications, just to not talk so much theoretically, just to see some things. Are there any products in the market for having byproducts from food waste? Citrus peel, for example, it was one of the first byproducts utilized for recovery purposes. Essential oils, flavonoids, sugar, and pectin, this was an extract that was recovered with solid extraction, and this industrial exploitation of citrus peel accounts for more than 30 years. There is a product called sugar syrup to use as an additive to enhance sweetness and flavor of juices. Other example is lycopene from tomato waste. There is now an industrial process to recover lycopene from tomato pomas, since there are a lot of studies in vitro, in vivo, and ex vivo that have demonstrated the radical activity, and of course that are inversely associated to diseases like cancers and cardiovascular diseases. Other examples are ketosan with its polysaccharide recovered from natural shrimps and crab cells that is used and sold as thickener in vegetable oils or an anti-elasticity agent in meat products. Here I have a table with the, you can see the different products, the patent, and also the company that commercialized these products. Cheese whey is maybe the most successful example of reutilization of byproducts in the food industry. Cheese whey is rich in proteins and sugars. Sometimes is sold directly as a drink, or can be used to recover this kind of compounds, lactose, to use as sweetener or proteins that is used in nutritional supplements in bodybuilding. And here we can see some companies, Alfa Laval, Davisco, and Kraft Foods, that have commercialized the process to recover this kind of compounds from cheese whey. Olive meal waste is, so to say, the new trend in the field. Probably you are familiar with olive oil production that produce the classic olive oil production with the three-phase centrifugal production. Produce olive oil, olive kernel, and olive meal wastewater. Olive kernel used to be a byproduct and for many years. So 40 years ago, it used to be also waste. But all these years is used to recover olive kernel oil. So this is a kind of byproduct that is it's not considered anymore byproducts, considered as a product. Over the last decade, scientists focus on only meal waste to recover polyphenols, and who knows, perhaps in some years this is going to be established a commodity, as an established source of polyphenols. So in olive meal waste, we target basically polyphenols and hydroxyurethral, as I said. You can use it as an additive, as a preservative in bakery products and in other food products. Here I have a table with two companies, redeAGRO, which is very known in the US, and Genosa, a Spanish company, that recover hydroxyurethral and use it as an additive or a supplement. And there are also other commercialized applications, for example, dietary fibers from apple pomace, or soya bean albumin from soya protein waste, and or proanthocyanidin from grape and cranberry seeds. I made this research was in the about the commercialized applications 2 years ago. We found about 30-40 companies that recover high added value compounds from food waste and byproducts. But now the companies have been increased, they are much more. And of course, we didn't identify all the companies that exist in the world, but what I want to say is that this there is a tendency to have more products in the market from byproducts. Before closing, just a brief about our portfolio of books. The first was Food Waste Recovery. It was published 2 years ago. It's about processing technologies and industrial techniques. The second is about innovation studies in the food industry and different tools of implementation for different kinds of innovations in the food industry. We have nutraceuticals, a functional food components, the effect of that this book discusses the effect of processing technologies, of emerging technologies on nutraceutical functional foods. And then we have three books that discuss target byproducts, olive meal waste, grape processing byproducts, and coffee processing byproducts. You can also find the flyer outside with the first four books, but if you want any information, you can ask me and to tell you more details. So before closing, just to know that our food waste recovery group, we have an open innovation network that we provide training for the industry, webinars, e-learning courses, workshops, we have consulting services.